God is good to have given us this wonderful, wonderful opportunity to sing His praises. Would you agree on that? Say amen. And I'm thankful for people who can sing. There's people who can sing, and then there's people who their mama told them they can sing. Amen. And I'm thankful for all of that. And Sister Shea was just testifying just for a second there about our teenage years together, and many, many, many moons ago. She said last time they sang that, they were probably 13 or 14 years old. My friend, that's been a long, long time ago. And we used to stand around the piano literally for hours, just hours and hours and hours. This is before you had text messaging and video gaming and all that kind of stuff that's ruining young people's minds today. This is back when we had a piano and a song in our heart. And Jesus had washed us in His blood, and we wanted to sing about it, and the church wanted to hear it, believe it or not. And so our youth group up there, we used to sing, and just we'd get together and have all-night prayer meetings and all kinds of different things. And the fruit from that still remains. And I'm thankful. I'm very, very thankful for that. It's a huge blessing and a huge encouragement. Will you get your Bibles tonight and turn with us, please, this evening to the book of 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5. This is the last blood I'll ever need. Have you ever thought through that line in that song? We don't have Jesus still hanging on the cross in our church like Roman Catholics do. We believe that Jesus died once, once buried, once rose again from the dead, and God said, "Son, well done." That is in the last blood that was ever needed. He is the Lamb slain. And we need not attempt to slay or supplement that sacrificial offering of our darling Savior Jesus Christ. He did a good job. Can I get an amen on that, church? He's to be congratulated. He did a good job saving our souls. And all we have, we owe to Him. And I'm very thankful for that wonderful line in that song, "The Last Blood." Are you able to stand? If you are, please turn with us to 1 Peter chapter 5 and stand as we look at verses 1, 2, 3, and 4 this evening. It'll be a little more of a classroom setting once again because we've been talking for some time now about elders, and tonight we're going to continue our series of thoughts on elders. We began talking about the conference of elders in Acts chapter 15, verses 1 through 35. Then we moved on to the compensation of elders, 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 17 through 18. God gives us that very important qualification that there has to be qualifications met for elders to be compensated, but they are on the list of people who are entitled to the church's resources if they meet the qualifications in 1 Timothy 3 and Titus chapter 1. And then we began last week talking about the confrontation of elders. 1 Timothy 5 also adds that we're not to receive an accusation against an elder unless it's by the witness of two or three. And so we began to dig into that, and we saw the credible allegations that are needed and the compelling accountability and the challenging appraisals and the conspicuous awareness, all of that going together under the understanding of the confrontation of elders. And tonight, if the Lord's willing, I want to talk to you briefly about the matter of the crowning of elders. Read with me, if you would, please, in 1 Timothy chapter 5. And I'll read in verses 1 through 4. If you have your place there again, church, will you say amen? 1 Timothy 5, verses 1 through 4. "The elders which are among you, I exhort," Peter says, "who am also an elder, and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed." The admonition begins in verse 2. "Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being ensamples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive" what, church? "A crown of glory that fadeth not away." If the Lord's willing tonight, we'll talk about the crowning of elders. I'll allow you to be seated. And I know that the message this morning was a little bit lengthy, so I'll shave some off of this one so you can get home and watch Letterman. Well, he's been gone for a long time, hasn't he? You can tell I'm not kept up on some things here. Let's look at this passage, if we can, tonight with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 thoughts in mind that naturally come from this passage. We have been discovering together what the New Testament teaches about the role of elders in the local church. And I hope by now you are convinced that the Bible says a lot about this. I think we can pretty well check that box off, right? The Bible says a lot about elders. And I'm confused why this subject is so neglected and why these teachings are so fearful in churches. I find it to be a very comforting thing, what God is commanding us to do. And so as we look at it tonight, we are fast-forwarding to the Apostle Peter's comments on the administrative elders of the church. Now, it's important that you understand that Peter's comments were essential. We already have some of the teachings of the book of Acts, and we already have Paul's writings and the pastoral epistles, but we needed to hear from Peter. He's the one who's left that we really need to hear from on this subject. And the reason we need to hear from Peter is because that sort of completes the cycle of New Testament teaching. And we have it in the book of Acts, and we also have it in pastoral epistles. And now we're going to hear this general epistle of Peter, and we're going to hear from himself about what his understanding of the role of elders should be. So he begins with a personal testimony in verse number 1, and then he gets to the content in verses 2, 3, and 4. Let's go through these quickly. 7 things. Number 1, when we look at the crowning of elders in these 4 verses, we want to note, first of all, the need for experience with Christ. Now, let me frame it up this way. If you are expecting a crown as an elder, the first condition that must be met is an experience with Christ. You'll notice that Peter addresses that in verse 1. The elders which are among you, I exhort. And then he says this interesting thing, who am also an elder. Now I want to point this out to you because it's very important to the message. There were once apostles. Once those apostles faded out and were either executed or died, that left an unfillable vacancy. There are now no longer apostles. Now, it's important, and Brother Brown mentioned this morning in Sunday school, and I thought it was very important to reiterate this just a little bit tonight. It is important that you understand the role of apostles in the church. Their names are going to be on the foundations of the city of New Jerusalem. The apostles hold a lofty and high position in the inauguration and administration of the church. They were the ones whom Jesus personally handed the gospel over to oversee and manage the distribution of that gospel. And they are the ones who wrote the vast majority of our New Testament, and they are the ones whose faith was given to us. So we hold the apostles in high regard in the church. We believe the apostles had certain authority and certain gifts that no longer exist today. For example, you'll never catch me trying to raise somebody from the dead. Now, I wish I had that gift. I do, because there's a lot of people, I feel like I'm trying to raise them from the dead every Sunday morning at Sunday, right? And one fellow came to me one time and he said, Pastor, I want you to teach me how to pray. And I said, well, I'll teach you how to pray. Say, now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. I said, every time you come to church, you're asleep, man. And so sometimes I feel like raising people, but that's not for me to do. I know that I am not an apostle. The apostles were not only capable of raising people from the dead, we saw them do that in the book of Acts, we also saw them heal, and we saw them put their stamp on the canonized Bible. It was the Apostle John who lived the longest, died last, and he was responsible for ultimately placing his hands on the 66 books that you and I call the Bible today. And he said, these are God's Word. And so the apostles had an incredible role. This is what Jude referred to when he talked about contending for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. The apostles received that one faith, the faith, they received it from Jesus, and then they handed the faith to the church, and we possess the faith today. So Peter is one of those apostles. You'll notice it here that he testifies that he serves actually in a dual role. He says, we know that he's an apostle, but he also says in verse number 1, I am also an elder. He considered himself a functioning elder in the New Testament church. So that's an important thing in his introduction here, verse 1. The elders which are among you I exhort, who am also an elder. And then he goes on with his testimony and he adds, and a witness of the sufferings of Christ. Now let's qualify that. Did Peter see Jesus suffer? Yes. He saw him suffer in Gethsemane. He was there with him. And he actually saw him arrested, and even though he might not have been there in the pavement with Jesus when Jesus was stricken and beaten, nevertheless, he saw Jesus suffer, and he saw Jesus raised from the dead. Is that right, church? So he says, I am a witness of the sufferings of Christ. That's his experience with Christ. And he adds also, I am partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Now, this has a double meaning. He is talking about the future glory, but he is also saying, I was eyewitness to the manifest glory of Jesus Christ, and we draw from that, he is referring to the Mount of Transfiguration, where three apostles were actually included, Peter, James, and John. So he said, I have seen Jesus suffer and be glorified with my own eyes in my lifetime. Now, I want to add, if I may, that is his experience. I am not going to pretend to duplicate that experience in my life. I don't intend to try to counterfeit that experience in my life. But I have had my own experience with Jesus Christ. Can I get a witness on that? And if you're saved, so have you. So the first thing that he points out here in the list is the need for experience with Christ. Now, I'm hurrying on. Number two. The second thing that Peter wants to discuss when it comes to elders who are worthy of a crown is the need for eating with the church, not just an experience with Christ, but he said the elders have to be known for eating with the church. He said, well, we've got a fellowship, Paul. We all do that from time to time. That's not exactly what he's talking about. Verse 2, here's what he says, feed the flock of God which is among you. Now, this has the undertones of a shepherd, but it also has the undertones here of meal preparation for the church when it comes to feeding the church from the Word of God. That can be more complicated than it sounds, because there are some people in the church that are still drinking the milk of the Word. Then there are some people in the church that they are beyond that, and they desire the meat of the Word. And so routinely, a pastor, an elder, has to be prepared to feed the flock of God. I was in a meeting recently and heard a man take his text from Matthew chapter 7, straight is the gate and narrow is the way, and he proceeded to completely and entirely misrepresent that text. After reading it, he said, straight is the gate, narrow is the way, and then he took the next hour telling us how to cut your grass in straight lines. And I'm not exaggerating. He took the next hour telling us and trying to make some spiritual application out of driving a lawnmower. Listen to me. That is not feeding the flock. Right? That's more like candy. And I don't even like the flavor of that candy. That is not going to grow the people of God. That is not going to mature and strengthen and nourish the people of God. Now, this is one of my hobby horses. I'm not going to dwell on it, but I just want to point out to you that what he is saying here is that if you want to receive a crown, you have to feed the church. You have to feed them with the word of God. Is that sufficient, or do we need to go further? Are you all with me so far? So verse number one, he says, the elder who is worthy of a crown has a need for an experience with Christ. He says, number two, in verse two, the elder who is worthy of a crown, he points out the need for eating with the church. And by the way, if I could just comment for a moment as well, what you get on the Lord's Day, I've already eaten and enjoyed throughout my study during the week. And there are no limitations on the food that we get from heaven. God has a bountiful store. Can I get a witness on that, church? Preachers who run out of sermons and run out of ideas were never actually called. If you just preach the word, it's an inexhaustible source of food for the people of God. Am I right, church? Say amen. So the need for eating with the church. Thirdly, if you look in verse number two, he is going to tell us also that if the elder is worthy of a crown, he explains the need for executive custody. Now, this is where it may get a little touchy for some folks. Verse two, feed the flock of God which is among you, and then these next four words, taking the oversight thereof. God has always had a man, and God has always intended for congregations to be led by a physical pastor. Okay? Can I say that again? These people that are plugged into the Universal Invisible Church, they're going to have a hard time when they need to get married calling their Universal Invisible pastor. Or getting in contact with when their baby has a fever and they need somebody to pray, they're going to have a hard time getting in contact with their Universal Invisible pastor. God has deliberately placed a man inside of a congregation who is the preaching, teaching, feeding elder in that church. And because of his role in that capacity, because of his handling of God's word, he has been granted management authority in the church. Now, where does that authority come from? Is it because he's intellectual? Is it because he has good ideas? Is it because he behaves like a good executive? No, none of that. It has everything to do with his handling of God's word. I don't have the right to manage the church or suggest a direction for the church to go in unless I have book, chapter, and verse to defend that suggestion. If a pastor cannot give you book, chapter, and verse for what he is doing, there is a very, very dangerous direction that the church could be taken in. Am I correct on that, church? So he talks about the need for executive custody. The pastor of the church has been given and granted this very heavenly responsibility for management of the church. Now listen to me. I feel like I need to explain this just a little bit further. This is not my church. It's not my church. This is the Lord's church. Let me get that clear on you, okay? Are you with me? It's not my church. This church's money is not my money. This church's property and facility is not my facility. This is the Lord's church. And God reveals to the pastoral elder, he reveals the direction that he wants the church to go in based on that man's study of God's word. Now, I'm not a fan of ingenuity when it comes to the church. I'm not a fan of that. I'm not a fan of creativity even when it comes to the church. I think the church is supposed to be doing what this old book told us we were supposed to do. And so we don't come to rewrite this Bible. We come to reread this Bible, to study it, to digest it over and over and over. You say, what are we going to do when we've expounded all 66 books? Well, if I'm alive, we're going to start back over. Because every single generation needs to have vivid exposure to the Word of God to know what the church is supposed to do and how the church is supposed to behave. Isn't that right? So how does God speak? Well, he gives us his Bible. A pastor has the responsibility to study, to dig in, to analyze, and to put together an understandable lesson. It's called the feeding of the flock here. And once he does that, he delivers that to the congregation with the expectation that the congregation has such a respect for God's word that they'll do anything the Bible teaches. Now let me clarify here. I did not say you have to do everything the pastor says. What I said was you have to do everything the Bible teaches. We don't vote to do what the Bible has already told us to do. You see that? And so what he is giving to us here is a management clause. A management clause. Now, I don't have the time to dig in any further there. Let's move on. The need for an experience with Christ. Number two, the need for eating with the church. Number three, the need for executive custody. And look at the fourth thing, verse 2 as well. The need for eager care. Now look at verse 2. He says, taking the oversight thereof, and then these three words, not by constraint. Meaning that he feels in some way forced to have to manage the church. He feels constrained to do it, and if that is the case, he will serve with poor performance if he feels like he is constrained to do it. If a pastor is saying, well, I don't really want to preach, but I feel like this is my responsibility and I just have to do it, I doubt that man's calling. A preacher who has been truly called of God wants to communicate God's word to his congregation. He wants to do that. He is itching to do that. All right? This past Wednesday night when the service closed, guess what I thought about on the way home? What I'm going to be saying on Sunday. When this service closes this evening, guess what will be on my mind? I feel like singing a verse in a chorus of Willie Nelson's song here, "You Are Always On My Mind." You are. You know why? Because God has given me the responsibility to make sure that every person in this congregation is well-versed in the Word of God, and that means as regularly as we can, we meet together for the communication, the clear communication of God's Word, and I am excited and eager to do that. If we could add a fourth service, I would. Can I get a witness? If we could do it, if I could get away with it, I would. The church in the early church in Acts met every day. And so if that was manageable, if that was doable, I would certainly suggest that to our church. But I want you to understand that an elder is not someone who is reluctantly doing his job. He has to, with joy, communicate God's word. Somebody asked me a question one time. They said, "Preacher, are we ever going to have Awanas in our church?" And I said, "Yeah, I want to preach Sunday morning. I want to preach Sunday night. I want to preach Wednesday night." The need for eager care. Eager care. There's been times when I have approached younger preachers and said, "I need you to fill the pulpit tonight or this morning or so-and-so, sort of a short notice." And I've had them, can you believe it? I've had them tell me, "Oh, I'm not ready." Well, there's no such thing as that. Do you hear what I just said? If I call on you to fill the pulpit and you say, "Well, I'm not ready," I'm going to take that as a sign of laziness, and it'll be a long time before I ever call on you again. Do you hear what I just said? You're supposed to be ready all the time because you're supposed to be immersing yourself in God's word all the time. You see that? So eager care, that's the need of an elder who is worthy of a crown. I'm hurrying. Verse 2, one more thing in verse 2, letter E or number 5, the need for equal compensation. Now look what he says in verse number 2. Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly. And then this, not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind. Filthy lucre, if you're not familiar with that old King James term, it's just talking about greed. It's talking about the unethical effort to accumulate money and merchandise ministry. That's filthy lucre. It comes in all kinds of different forms. It comes in abuses of the church's funds. It could come in the form of charging for a service. I've never done that. Are you listening to me? I want you to hear what I just said. I have never suggested an offering. I've had people invite me before and say, "Pastor, you know, we're a small church. We don't have much." And I just hold my hand up and say, "Look, it doesn't matter to me. I will pay you to let me come preach." And listen to me, I have. Y'all looking at me like I got three eyes. Did you hear what I just said? There's been times I've told them, I said, "I'll get my own room. I'll pay my own expenses. If you feel like you need to have a meeting, I'm coming. And I'll be happy to do it, and I will absorb the cost of it myself." Why? Because I am eager to communicate the Word of God. That is my calling. That is my responsibility. That is my spiritual gift. Now, filthy lucre is the other way. This man one time sent a letter, and he said, "I will be, congratulations," the letter said, "congratulations, soon I'll be ministering in your church." And the letter went on and said, "I have some suggestions that I would like to make if I am going to be a guest in your church. If you would, please do these things for me to make my experience there as comfortable as possible." And he listed a list of particular restaurants that he liked to eat at. And he said it would be appreciated and expected that you will leave a gift basket in my lodging in my motel room, and please include low-calorie snacks. And he even used the word legumes in his letter. I don't know if I've ever even eaten a legume. I'm not even sure. He went on and on and on about what he expected and how he expected to be reimbursed for his airfare and how he expected to be compensated and how much this trip was going to cost, right down to the penny. "It'll cost me this much to travel and this much to return to my next meeting." And he just went on and on and on and on about that. And at the end of it, my conclusion is, this man is greedy of filthy lucre. Are you listening? And so we don't host people like that. Even Joe Arthur, our dear friend Joe Arthur, I asked Brother Joe, I said, "Brother Joe, you're going to have to tell me." I said, "You're a nationally known preacher. What do you expect from us? What do you expect?" He said, "Brother Brad," he said, "you know better than to ask me that question." He said, "I'll come down there for nothing." And that is the spirit of a man who is not merchandising God's word. He wants God's word communicated, even if he has to absorb the cost of it. Now understand something with me. There is a cost to it. And when we host a preacher, we always give them an offering, a very generous offering, and we cover considerable amounts of expenses and meals or whatever it is that may be needed there. We are good to God's men. That's why God's blessed our church the way he has. But there's a problem when a man expects more than you give him. This has happened to me on occasion, where men have returned their offering and said, "You need to adjust this offering. You need to reconsider. It's too low. It needs to be more." And I just want to kick them right in their rear end. They only come one time. If that happens, that's filthy lucre, isn't it? That's filthy lucre. And then if you're not careful, they'll show up with a table. It'll look like a flea market out in the church for you. They'll show up with shirts and T-shirts, and they'll show up with hats and ties, and show up with a couple of Bibles and recordings and everything under the sun. And they're selling this stuff and charging enormous prices for it. And you have to look at them and wonder, you know, I mean, does this person know what it's like to live by faith? In some cases, they do not. I don't believe that a church ought to keep a preacher poor. Can I get a witness on that? I think we would all agree there. I don't think a church ought to keep a preacher poor, but Peter says right here, if you want a crown, you can't be focused on the cash. Right? You got to be willing to do it for whatever. One of my mentors, Dr. Seitler, he would, when he was invited to preach as a guest in a church, he would often, if it was in driving distance, he would often load up a bus full of Tabernacle Baptist Church members and take them with him. And on one particular meeting that Dr. Seitler was doing on the closing night of the meeting, which would have been a Saturday night, Clemson was playing football, and there was hardly anybody that was willing to go on the bus. And so the only people that showed up was Dr. Seitler and one other man who was a deacon in the church and a rather poor man. And so Dr. Seitler got on the bus, and they drove to this couple of counties over to this meeting, preached, and the little treasurer of the church came up to Dr. Seitler with a brown paper bag, and it was all wrinkled and used, and nodded his head, he held his head down low and handed Dr. Seitler that paper bag and said, "I wish we could do more, but this is all we can do," and handed him that paper bag. Dr. Seitler graciously looked at him and said, "I'm sure it's more than I'm worthy of. Thank you for your generosity." And he received that unknown offering in that paper bag, and he just stuck it down in the pocket of his coat and said, I'll appreciate anything you all have done." So he got on the bus. He never even opened that brown paper bag up, never even opened it. And when he got on the bus, he pulled it out of his pocket, handed it over to that deacon, and he said, "Look, I want you to have this. I don't even know how much it is." He said, it's probably not going to be much from this little church, but he said, "I want you to have this." And that deacon took that from him and thanked him. And he said, "Dr. Seitler, you earned this." And Dr. Seitler said, I'm blessed. I don't need it. I want you to have this." So that deacon got home, and around midnight, Dr. Seitler's phone rang, because that deacon opened that brown paper bag, and there was $2,500 in cash money in that brown paper bag. And Dr. Seitler said, "Well, I might be needing some of that back then, my dear brother." Y'all know James Jones? Dr. James Jones? Brother Tony, you know him. Brother Don, you know a bunch of you guys. You know Dr. James Jones? One of the most gentlemanly preachers in the world. And when we hosted Dr. Jones in our church, we gave him a generous offering. And just days later, a check came back in the mail from Dr. Jones. He said it was too much. Where are those preachers now that are not in it for the money, not greedy of filthy lucre? Much more I could say. Verse 3, I have to hurry now. Not just let me remind you, the need for experience with Christ, the need for eating with the church, the need for executive custody, the need for eager care, but now in verse, and the need for equal compensation, excuse me, but now in verse number 3, the need for exemplary conduct. If you want a crown, you have to be an example. That means you have to be comfortable with people watching you. So he says in verse number 3, neither as being lords over God's heritage, that's a way of talking about the church, neither as being lords over God's heritage, that's a possessive noun there, a possessive proper noun, this is God's church. You're not the lord of it, and neither am I. You got that? So he says, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but what? Being in samples to the flock. You'll notice the unusual spelling of that word, in samples. We would be more customarily we would be more accustomed to using the word example. But there's a difference between an example and an in sample. An in sample here, he is referring to you are leading by example the congregation that you are a part of. Do you see that? So one of the ways that a pastor gets close to his church is by being among them. Opening line of verse 1, the elders which are among you, I exhort. So there has to be an affinity for being with the people of God. And that is where example comes from. You have to be close enough to them so they can see your marriage. Close enough to them so they can see your finances. Close enough to them so that they can see your behavior, your conversation, your deportment. All of those things are necessary. This is what Paul told Timothy. He said, "You have fully known my doctrine, my manner of living." And so knowing your pastor is not going to be successful if he is in some lofty tower separated from the people, separated from the congregation, and is inaccessible. That is not what the Bible teaches. Neither is being Lord. You don't just come out of your office and bark some orders once in a while. What do? You lead out front. You lead by example. I don't think I need to comment any further on that. The need for exemplary conduct. Lastly, the need for an expected crown. Now, I'm doing this for two reasons. Reason number two is because I love you. I want you to get comfortable with that. But reason number one is because I love Jesus Christ. I love you second, and I love Jesus first. Right? I love Jesus so much that when I preach, I imagine that He is my audience. I don't even preach in consideration of how this crowd feels. I imagine that Jesus is front and center and that He is judging what I preach. He is listening to what I preach. And I am of the assumption that if I am pleasing to Him, if you love that same Jesus that I love, then you're going to appreciate what is preached. You see that? And here's what it says. Verse 4, He puts this right in our place. When the chief shepherd shall appear. Now that assumes that I'm not that chief shepherd. Am I a shepherd? Yes. I'm feeding the flock? Yes. Managing the church? Yes. Presbyter of the church? Yes. All of those things intact. But that still does not allow me to supersede the chief shepherd. And according to that verse, one day He's coming back. And when He's coming, when He comes back, those who have been faithful, according to the description of verses 1 through 4, will receive a crown of glory. All right, we got to talk a minute. Crown. There is a crown known as the diadema. And then there's that other one. Pardon me for forgetting the Greek word for it. But then there's that other crown, which is, it refers to the laurel leaf crown. And in Roman games and Greek games back in those days, everybody who crossed the finish line would receive what was known as the fading crown or the laurel leaf crown. You wear it proudly, but in a day or so, it's just going to rot. It's literally a wreath of laurel leaves. So He says, there is that crown that fades, but you'll notice it says here, man, I'm about to get in the glory. You don't receive that kind of crown. He says, you receive a crown of glory that what? Fadeth not away. I take that to mean that forever in heaven I will be a pastor. Now, I won't be yours anymore because you won't need that. There are crowns that you will receive, but according to this verse, if I cross the finish line and I have served well, I will receive at the judgment a crown, diadema, that's the word, that a crown of, it's the wording here is literally diadema a doxa. It is a crown of glory. The word doxa, where we get our word doxology from, is glory. So He says, you're going to receive a crown of glory, and then He adds this, that fadeth not away. I'm not doing this for you. I'm doing this so that one day I can get that crown and give it back to Him. That's it. Are you looking at me? If this church never pays me another salary, I'll still do what I do. You know why? Because it's not about the money. It is about pleasing the Lord. Now, don't get any ideas in your head and say, oh, this is going to be real cheap from here forward. All right. What I am saying to you is that a true God-called man of God is not concerned about the money. He is concerned about pleasing the Lord And he's concerned about the crown, the diadem. I don't know how else to tell you this other than just to say, I do what I do because I love Jesus. And as a bonus, I get to have all of these wonderful people on the same team. It thrills my soul every time I walk in this sanctuary to be in a room like this with this many people who love Christ. It thrills my soul. And I am convinced that you love the Bible and you believe the Bible. And so I don't have to fight with you. I don't have to contend with you. I'm able to just come in and say, here's what the Bible says. Our heads all nod up and down. Sometimes we utter an amen. And God is pleased with the seamless garment of unity in the church. Is that right, congregation? The church is a team. It is a congregation of people who have a pastor. And when God has found a church that is in that blessable state, not a pastor who's chewing on his people and not people who are fighting against their pastor, but when God finds a church that is in that blessable state, God's blessings begin to rain down on that church. And you'd have to be blind and only have half a brain and a broken pencil to see, to be ignorant of how God has blessed our church. Something is right here. Are you with me, church? Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your eternal word and its instructions for us. In these Sunday nights, just slowing down a little bit and spending some time in your word to learn what it says have been precious to me. I hope they've been a blessing to all of us. Tonight, Father, as we look at the crowning of an elder, I speak with anxious excitement because I believe that Jesus could come at any moment. And I must confess, Lord, I want to be found faithful. Help us all, Lord, to have that testimony. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name. Now, some are praying. Would you stand for just a few moments?